وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to Quran Circle 2. I'm Arkam Rashid, your host. Today's topic is ethical guidance, and we have selected some verses from Surah An-Nur. So let's start off, as usual, by introducing and welcoming our guest for today. On my right-hand side, I have Sheikh Ibrahim Zidane. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh. Sheikh Ibrahim, if I can ask you quickly, what was Surah An-Nur named after?
Surah An-Nur means the light. Mm-hmm. And the light is mentioned in the surah when it described and talked about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 35. Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the light of the heavens and the earth. And the surah is all about the light of guidance, the light of how a person should conduct his life. Because this life is like as if it's total darkness. And unless we have this light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the revelation from Allah, then we will be able to walk in this life and to act. Relationships between people, between men and women, the masajid, the houses of Allah, this is the place where we acquire the light, which is the subject of this wahy, the revelation. And that's why the light will spread all over the earth that way, by the wahy, revelation from Allah.
Nurun ala nur.
No.
Okay. Now I'm going to introduce our reciters for today. Our first reciter is one of the stars on Huda TV's Correct Your Recitation. His name is Abdul Khaliq Atiya. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Next to him, we have Ibrahim Sa'id. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam. Welcome.
So starting us off today with his amazing recitation is Qari Abdul Khaliq from verse number 27 of Surah An-Nur. So go ahead, open your mushafs, follow along and enjoy.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la tadkhulu buyutan ghayra buyutikum hatta tasta'nisu wa tusallimu ala ahliha dhalikum khayrun lakum la'allakum tadhakkarun. فإن لم تجدوا فيها أحدا فلا تدخلوها حتى يؤذن لكم وإن قيل لكم ارجعوا فارجعوا هو أزكى لكم والله بما تعملون عليم. ليس عليكم جناح أن تدخلوا بيوتا غير مسكونة فيها متاع لكم والله يعلم ما تبدون وما تكتمون. قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم ويحفظوا فروجهم ذلك أزكى لهم إن الله خبير بما يصنعون. وقل للمؤمنات يغضضن من أبصارهن ويحفظن فروجهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا ما ظهر منها وليضربن بخمرهن على جيوبهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا لبعولتهن أو آبائهن أو آباء بعولتهن أو أبنائهن أو أبنائهن ذريتهن أو إخوانهن أو إخوانهن أو بني إخوانهن أو بني أخواتهن أو نسائهن أو نسائهن أو ما ملكت أيمانهن أو التابعين غير أولي الإربة أو التابعين غير أولي الإربة من الرجال أو الطفل الذين لم يظهروا على عورات النساء ولا يضربن بأرجلهن ليعلم ما يخفين من زينتهن وتوبوا إلى الله جميعا أيها المؤمنون لعلكم تفلحون وأنكحوا الأيامى منكم والصالحين من عبادكم وإمائكم إن يكونوا فقراء يغنهم الله من فضله والله واسع عليم وليستعفف الذين لا يجدون نكاحا حتى يغنيهم الله من فضله والذين يبتغون الكتاب مما ملكت أيمانكم فكاتبوهم إن علمتم فيهم خيرا وآتوهم مما لله الذي آتاكم ولا تكرهوا فتياتكم على البغاء إن أردنا تحصنا لتبتغوا عرض الحياة الدنيا ومن يكرهن فإن الله من بعد إكراههن غفور رحيم ولقد أنزلنا إليكم آيات مبينات ومثلا من الذين خلوا من قبلكم وموعظة للمتقين الله نور السماوات والأرض مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح المصباح في زجاجة الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار نور على نور يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم في بيوت بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار ليجزيهم الله أحسن ما عملوا ويزيدهم من فضله والله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب والذين كفروا أعمالهم كسراب بقيعة يحسبه الظمآن ماء حتى إذا جاءه لم يجده شيئا ووجد الله عنده فوفاه حسابه والله سريع الحساب أو كظلمات في بحر لجي يغشاه موج من فوقه موج سحاب ظلمات بعضها فوق بعض إذا أخرج يده لم يكد يراها ومن لم يجعل الله له نورا فما له من نور ألم تر أن الله يسبح له من في السماوات والأرض والطير صافات ألم تر أن الله يسبح له من في السماوات والأرض والطير صافات كل قد علم صلاته وتسبيحه والله عليم بما يفعلون ولله ملك السماوات والأرض وإلى الله المصير ألم تر أن الله يزجي سحابا ثم يؤلف بينه ثم يجعله ركاما فترى الودق يخرج من خلاله وينزل من السماء من جبال فيها من برد فيصيب به يشاء ويصرفه عن من يشاء يكاد سنا برقه يذهب بالأبصار يكاد سنا برقه يذهب بالأبصار يقلب الله الليل والنهار يقلب الله الليل والنهار إن في ذلك لعبرة لأولي الأبصار والله خلق كل دابة من ماء فمنهم من يمشي على بطنه ومنهم من يمشي على رجلين ومنهم من يمشي على أربع يخلق الله ما يشاء إن الله على كل شيء قدير.
جزاكم الله خير. Thank you very much, Qari Abdul Khaliq. That was wonderful. Thank you.
جزاكم الله خير.
If you can just give us the Sunnah way of knocking on somebody's door, going to the house.
Alhamdulillah. Before getting into this, it's important to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. Mm-hmm. And when there's something order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to the believers, it has a great wisdom.
Yes.
The etiquettes of getting into someone's house, it's done in such a way and it's explained in the Quran, the words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jibreel alayhi salam comes down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with Quran teaching the believers how to even take permission to enter someone's house. Why is that? To protect the honors and dignities of the believers and to protect them from falling into sins and from having their eyes to fall into something that is forbidden for them, to look at someone's wife or someone's daughter. So this is something that if you go all over the Muslim world, this is something that needs to be always observed. Mm-hmm. Makes us unique, this matter of chastity and protecting our honor and dignity. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade the believers to just enter the homes of others without making sure that they tastanisu, meaning that they take permission before they enter, and they would say salam. These two things before they enter. The salam is not after they enter. Some people, they enter and they give salam. No, the salam is before they enter. Mm-hmm. So they would make clear that this is so and so person. He's taking permission, can I come in? And then he would say, Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Can I come in? Mm-hmm. Right? Whatever, it's different languages, but these two things has to be there. That giving the salam and asking for permission. And he won't enter till the host will let him enter. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is better for you. That's why the host, he has the right to say, I'm busy now, or can you come later? Most people, they would be very upset with this. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us that if you are told to irji'u, وَقِيلَ لَكُمْ irji'u, فَرْجِعُهُ أَزْكَ لَكُمْ. If you are told to go back, go back, it's more purifying for you. It's a purifying thing for you. So never get upset as a result of this, again, because people, you don't know what people are busy with or so. So taking permission, saying salam, and entering. And once a person enters, he should basically wait for the host to tell him where to sit and where to go. Mm-hmm. He should not just enter and then he walks whatever he wants. He would, you know, follow the instructions, and even the host, he should tell him where to sit. Because maybe if he sits in a place where his eyes can see, you know, things that he's not supposed to see. So he has to wait till the host tell him where to sit. Mm-hmm. And while, once he enters, he's observing, lowering his gaze. He has to lower his gaze at all times. If a door opens, if something like this, to observe the rights of the host of the house and to protect their honor and dignity.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, these concepts now, they're very normal. I mean, people always ask permission to enter somebody's house. They even call before. But I want to understand, you know, something so basic like this. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us this because maybe in that society they used to just enter each other's house. It was part of their culture just to walk inside somebody's house.
No, there used to be no doors for the houses. The houses used to have just an entrance, but there's no doors locked. So this is another thing that people might just feel at ease to walk in. Right. So when there's something is closed, then it makes it different. But also nowadays, when the doors are closed and everything, people sometimes knock on the door and they stand right in front of the door. Right, that's against the etiquette, which is mentioned in the ayah implicitly. That if you knock on someone's door, that's basically taking permission, you need to either turn to the right or to the left, so that when the door is opened, your eyes is not right in there. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said that al-isti'dhan, or taking permission, why is it been legislated? Min ajl al-basar. It's because of the eyes. This is why there's etiquettes that we need to observe. All of this is because of your eyes doesn't see something that you're not supposed to see. So when people, you know, the door is closed, but they're standing right there. Where can you open the door? Right. So you have to look or stand to the right or to the left. And the second thing is, when people get to enter the house, they're not free to go anywhere they want to go. Right. They have to still follow the host of the house, which is still things that people need to learn how to observe.
And that person standing right in front of the door, that's kind of me. I didn't know this. That's why when I was, whenever I go somewhere with my Egyptian friends, we knock on the door and then he moves to the side. I'm just standing there, I go, okay. If you ever notice, they always move to the side and wait for the guy to open the
door. But at the same time, not to move away totally, because if a person wants to see who's outside, he should see somebody. So not to move out of the way, but to just to weigh in a way that his eyes would not fall into the what's inside of the house.
Okay. And if we look at verse number 29, it says, "Wallahu ya'lamu ma tubduna wa ma taktumun." Is this speaking about Allah knows your intentions? So if you're doing it with this intention, then obviously it falls in that. But if you do it by accident or something like that, then it doesn't.
Right. And this is how the believers, they always are watchful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't just expect what people say about us, physical actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in our hearts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees what's in the hearts. And that's why it comes in the context of lowering the gaze. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He knows يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنُ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. He knows the betrayal of the eyes. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said that a person would be in the house of someone and he steals a look. You know, a woman passes and he steals a look. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in the heart of that person, that if he has the means to see her without any clothes, he would do that. And this is such a dangerous thing. So that's why a person has to lower the gaze, not just to deceive people. Oh, mashallah, he's a pious brother. He's looking down. No, he's doing that for the sake of Allah. He's protecting himself and honoring this other Muslim, because this is a betrayal thing. When a Muslim looks at another woman that is not permissible for him to see, he's betraying not just her, betraying the men, you know, her husband, her brother, her father. And this is what we as Muslims, we see our families and our women in our life. When it comes to even looks, and that's why we're ordered to lower the gaze.
So that, I mean, that's part of Islamic ethics. We can say that it's unethical for a Muslim to look at somebody else's sister or mother or daughter.
Right.
Why does Allah start with, just the last question before we go to the break, why does Allah start with قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ and then lower their gaze, and then He says قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ lower their gaze?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers, and then the males and the females, and actually what's important is that it's the order is not to the believers in general. This was mentioned specifically for men and then mentioned again for women to make sure that nobody would have an ambiguity in it. Oh, it's maybe for men only or for women only. But of course, men, they are asked more because the matter is more stressed for them. Men in general, they are seekers of women. And women with her fitra, she is to be sought. Nowadays, actually, the fitra, sometimes it's mixed. And it's distorted, but this is the norm of the human beings. So that's why the order for men is more stressed. They need to lower their gaze. And they are the ones that are outgoing, going outside, working and so on. And that's why Muslims, they need to be patient. People might ridicule you. They say, why you're looking down and things like this. This is part of our ethics. And this is something that we need to observe, because this is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also for the females. For the women, they are ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lower their gaze, not just for the men. And you would see this, it's a very strange thing. Sometimes you would find the brother lowering his gaze, but the sister, she's just looking right there. This is not permissible. They both need to lower their gaze. and they only see what is permissible for them to see.
Okay. Sheikh, we'll continue this conversation right after we go for a short break. Dear viewers, stay tuned, because soon as we come back, we will continue with the recitation of Surah An-Nur until the end of the surah, and then we will continue our conversation on ethics. So stay tuned.
وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ.
This is Mamdouh Muhammad, and I'd like to remind you that we are humans, and humans err and make mistakes. If you think that you make mistakes, if you think that you have sins, if you want your sins to be erased, and I'm sure that everybody wants, this is the golden opportunity. Join me in the month of Ramadan at this program, The Oasis of Ramadan, at Huda TV.
إذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
Welcome to Quran Circle 2. Now we will continue our conversation on ethical guidance, but before we do that, we will start off by listening to a beautiful recitation from a very young reciter, Qari Ibrahim Saeed. So go ahead, open your Mushaf to Surah An-Nur, verse number 46. Follow along and enjoy.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم لقد أنزلنا آيات مبينات والله يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم ويقولون آمنا بالله وبالرسول وأطعنا ثم يتولى فريق منهم من بعد ذلك وما أولئك بالمؤمنين وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ وَإِنْ يَكُنْ لَهُمُ الْحَقُّ يَأْتُوا إِلَيْهِ مُذْعِنِينَ أَفِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ أَمِ ارْتَابُوا أَمْ يَخَافُونَ أن يحيف الله عليهم ورسوله بل أولئك هم الظالمون إنما كان قول المؤمنين إذا دعوا إلى الله ورسوله ليحكم بينهم أن يقولوا سمعنا وأطعنا وأولئك هم المفلحون ومن يطع الله ورسوله ويخشى الله ويتقه فأولئك هم الفائزون وأقسموا بالله جهد أيمانهم لئن أمرتهم ليخرجن قل لا تقسموا طاعة معروفة قل لا تقسموا طاعة معروفة إن الله خبير بما تعملون قل أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول فإن تولوا فإنما عليه ما حمل وعليكم ما حملتم وإن تطيعوه تهتدوا وما على الرسول إلا البلاغ المبين وعد الله الذين آمنوا منكم وعملوا الصالحات ليستخلفنهم في الأرض كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم وليمكنن لهم دينهم الذي ارتضى لهم وليبدلنهم من بعد خوفهم أمنا يعبدونني لا يشركون بي شيئا ومن كفر بعد ذلك فأولئك هم الفاسقون وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وأطيعوا الرسول لعلكم ترحمون لا تحسبن الذين كفروا معجزين في الأرض ومأواهم النار ولبئس المصير يا أيها الذين آمنوا ليستأذنكم الذين ملكت أيمانكم والذين لم يبلغوا الحلم منكم يا أيها الذين آمنوا ليستأذنكم الذين ملكت أيمانكم والذين لم يبلغوا الحلم منكم يا أيها الذين آمنوا ليستأذنكم الذين ملكت أيمانكم والذين لم يبلغوا الحلم منكم ثلاث مرات من قبل صلاة الفجر وحين تضعون ثيابكم من الظهيرة ومن بعد صلاة العشاء ثلاث عورات لكم ليس عليكم ولا عليهم جناح بعدهن طوافون عليكم بعضكم على بعض كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات والله عليم حكيم وإذا بلغ الأطفال منكم الحلم فليستأذنوا كما استأذن الذين من قبلهم كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته والله عليم حكيم والقواعد من النساء اللاتي لا يرجون نكاحا فليس عليهن جناح أن يضعن ثيابهن غير متبرجات بزينة وأن يستعففن خير لهن والله سميع عليم.
جزاكم الله خير. Thank you very much, Qari Ibrahim. That was wonderful. Thank you. Sheikh, so in the previous segment, we spoke about some of the etiquettes of entering a person's house, and then we spoke about men and women lowering their gazes. What I want to do is I want to continue from the verses from there all the way to wherever we read until, which is verse number 60, I believe. So if we look after the verses of telling the believers to lower their gazes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the dress code for women. If you can touch upon this, then we'll move on, inshallah.
Naam. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulullah. The dress code, which is something that is related to lowering the gaze, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered both men and women to observe certain rules when it comes to what they show and what they should not show. Here in these verses talks about the women and the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them to wear the hijab and to cover their body, since the body of the woman is to be covered, and to even hide any form of zina or any form of adornment that would attract others. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that only specific individuals, they are the ones that permissible for the woman to show her adornment. And this is specifically mentioned in the verse in number 31. And these are the mahalim of the women. Mm-hmm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordering them after that, since they're ordered to lower their gaze and to observe certain dress code, if it's correct to say, then it becomes very difficult for the people if they do not get themselves to get married if they have the means to do so. And that's why when we look at the orders in the Deen of Al-Islam, it's not just one order and then we do not apply the rest of the Deen of Al-Islam. People would see this as a strict orders if they're living their life where people have mixed relationships, free relationships, and marriages delayed and things like this. Yes, it becomes very difficult. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنْكِحُوا الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ. Get them married, right? Because now the matter becomes very strict for them to have any enjoyment when it comes outside of the fold of the marriage. Therefore, the encouragement here is to get married. And this is one of the wisdom behind all of these rules, so that the marriage as an institute becomes very strong. Otherwise, why would people get married then if they can fulfill their desires elsewhere? That's what we see in the West and many parts of the world. For us as Muslims to get married when a person is young, this is something that is recommended. And the Prophet ﷺ stressed that to the young people. And with all of these orders, and then comes into the verses that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the nur, being the light of the heavens and the earth. This is all related. And if a person wants to receive the light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person needs to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's the only one worthy of worship, and following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, otherwise this light will go away from the hearts of the people when they commit sin, especially with their eyes and so on.
Okay. Sheikh, if we can come to verse number 37. It speaks about people who don't busy themselves with trade and buying and selling. What is this ruling that we can extract from this verse? No.
This ruling came right after the ayah that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the light of the heavens and earth. And as if, as the ulama, they say, the next verse talks about fi buyutin adhina Allahu an turfa, in houses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the permission for it to be erected, the masajid. So as if the verse is saying this is the places where the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for people to acquire, and that is to make their salah, to establish their salah in the masajid. The masjid is an essential part of the Muslim life. And therefore, when it comes to the masajid, the most important act to be observed is the 5 daily salah. Mm-hmm. 5 daily salah. Being in the masjid, this is the job of the men in this life. And they do everything else to make it easy for them to go to the masjid, not the opposite. Mm-hmm. And that's why the ayah says these are men, the people that are in the masajid, in the houses of Allah. There are men, that's why it's not obligatory for the women. Mm. And there are men that the tijara or the trade and buying and selling, does not take them away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and establishing the salah and giving the zakah. Why? Because they fear a day when everything will be changed. And that's why it's a mandatory thing for men to go to the masjid, to go to the houses of Allah, and to observe the obligatory salah the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did. Otherwise, the more the person away from the masjid, the more or the less light that the person acquired. And if the person is in darknesses, that means he's deviated. That means he's not knowing what is right and what is wrong. So this is the minimum requirement for a good Muslim, that the Muslim men are in the masajid and the Muslim women, they observe the hijab. And the hijab is a way of life, it's not just a piece of clothing.
Yeah, of course.
And they're away from the eyes of men, away from the free mixing and so on. And this is how the family unit in Islam is very strong to establish the deen of Allah. Mm. You have to be careful that the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they know that and they try to break that among the Muslim ummah, to take the men away from the masajid and to take the women away from their homes and away from their hijab, so that then everything else becomes easy for them to follow the ways of the disbelievers.
And one thing you mentioned was that this verse comes after a very beautiful verse, which is Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal Ard. We can get one of the reciters, inshallah, if Qari Abdul Khaliq doesn't mind reciting for us Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal Ard, that one ayah, please.
الله نور السماوات والأرض مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح المصباح في زجاجة الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار نور على نور يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم.
Jazakallah khair. Thank you very much, Qari Abdul Khaliq. Thank you. Sheikh, if you could just give us a brief tafsir of that verse and then we'll move on with our conversation, inshallah.
This beautiful verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stating the fact that He is the Nur, He is the light of the heavens and the earth. And one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is An-Nur. And then He gave an example or a parable that people can understand, but nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the like of the nur, of the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, something that makes the light something that is so pure. It's a place where you have in the side of a wall or in the side of a tree where it has a lamp, and the lamp is in the glass, and the glass is like a star, and it's giving the light, or the light is coming from a zaytuna, from olive, which is something that is so pure. And that the zayt or the oil itself, it's almost to be lit without even having fire there. How pure that light is, and that's the point of it. That it's a light that is so pure. It's not contaminated with anything. It's not a hurtful or harmful light. And that's why it's nurun ala nur. It's light over light. And the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of it. And it shows that whoever seek guidance and light or anything from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would never attain anything. And that's why only the light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be followed. And that's why the surah is called An-Nur. And that's why it's not just the physical light, but also the non-physical light in this life, that everything in this life, everybody is in total darkness, unless they have a share of that light, which is the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Thank you for that, Sheikh. Now, one of the things that are mentioned in was about sami'na wa ata'na. And this concept of when you hear what God has told you to do, or when you hear what the Prophet ﷺ has told you that God has commanded us to do, then we say sami'na wa ata'na and conduct this. But obviously we don't live in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. What I want to know is that, say for example, somebody tells a Muslim that this is part of Islam or this is what the Prophet ﷺ told you to do. Does he have to verify that or is he obligated to do it right there and then?
No, if a person is someone that is of no knowledge or weak in knowledge, then he should make sure that he takes that knowledge from someone that he trusts his knowledge. So if the one that told him this is a scholar in the deen of Islam, someone that he trusts his knowledge in his religion, then he should take that. But if he has doubts, or if the person is not a knowledgeable person, not a scholar in the deen of Islam, then he needs to verify, especially with living in a time when anybody can share anything, and everybody can have access to anything. So people, for example, circulating mails or whatever there is and they're staying, saying this is from the deen, this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, people should not take that for granted. They need to make sure that it's authentic, because it's basically the difference between light and darknesses. If something sounds good, but it's not what the Prophet ﷺ said, or before that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's not light, it's darkness, right? And that's why we don't really see what is light and what is darkness, based on our ability and our intellect. Otherwise, the disbelievers, many of them, they are very smart, but they're not able to see what is right and what is wrong. So what is right and what is wrong is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's part of the faith. If we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship, then we listen and we obey. And that makes this ummah unique. This is, you can put a title for this ummah, this is the ummah of sami'na wa ata'na. We listen and we obey. The nations before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned them because they would say sami'na wa asayna. We listen and we disobey as Bani Israel and others. So this is what makes this ummah unique, and this is what the strength that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give and the support and the help to this ummah. Once it's not as strong, once they turn away from this clear way of life, of sami'na wa ata'na, we listen and we obey, then all kinds of punishments and misery can afflict them in this life and in the hereafter.
Okay, and if we look at verse number 56, and many verses in the Quran in general, speak about these two pillars of Islam, which is وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ and وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ. And many other places in the Quran you also find to establish prayer and to give zakat. This is one of many ayahs, like we said. What I want to know is, why is it considered unethical in Islam if a person doesn't pay his zakat or doesn't pray his salah?
It's unethical because it's disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what ethic and non-ethical in Islam. It's about obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even when we conduct ourselves towards one another, because it's all for the sake of Allah. When it comes to establishing the salah, someone that is betrays the covenant between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how can he be trusted in anything else? Right? This is another thing. So the one that doesn't pray, we don't trust him, basically, because he needs to basically fulfill the covenant between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. And the same thing when it comes to zakah. Zakah, the small portion of one's wealth, and it's not from everybody, like taxes, this is for only specific people, those who are considered to be rich and they're not really in need of this money. The small portion of zakah, this is not this person's money. And that's how the ethical part of it is. This is belong to the poor and not belong to you. So when you're giving it, you're not doing a favor to the poor. You're doing a favor to yourself. You're purifying your own wealth. So you won't have this attitude of arrogance, or I'm benefiting others, or I'm doing a favor to the poor by giving my zakah. This is unethical in Islam, because we're supposed to do it with humbleness. This is the right of the poor. This is their right. And this is something that is good for you to purify yourself. So you give it with love, with humbleness, that you'll be the one that is looking for the poor and not humiliating the poor and so on and so forth. So it's all part of this ethics. And that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the previous verses talking about those hypocrites, those one that are called to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they turn away. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questioned what's in their hearts, why they're turning away. They have to choose one of three. Either they have a disease in their hearts, or they have doubts that this is the truth, or they are afraid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do injustice to them, him and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when people withhold their zakah, for example, or don't establish the salah, do they have disease in their heart? Or they're in doubt? Or do they think that Allah would ruin their lives if they establish the salah? Would they be poor and miserable if they give the zakah? This is a question to show how evil that is. Because definitely that's not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to purify our souls, wants to purify our wealth, wants us to live the best life on the face of earth and in the hereafter if we would follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Sheikh, now the last verse that we recited today, verse number 60, وَالْقَوَاعِدُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, what is it speaking about?
Now, after talking about the hijab and the importance of the hijab, and we didn't of course give it its rights, and that's why the viewers, they need to do the work of understanding what was the hijab at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and what these verses means, and it's his way of life, and for the women to be concealed, their beauty concealed away from the eyes of men, not a piece of clothing that Muslim women sometimes they put the hijab as if it's a symbol. Hijab is not a symbol of anything. Hijab is a way of life. It has a job for it to be observed. And therefore, after that, the verses talked about those women who reached an old age where they're not seeking marriage and nobody would seek them for marriage. So the old age is a relative thing, right? So what the age is it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْقَوَاعِدُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. It's the women, these are the women that nobody will desire them whatsoever to get married to, and they don't have any desire to get married. So you can talk about very old age, 70, 80, something like this, although some of them are, mashallah, are young, but it's the age where they're not seeking anything and they're not sought. So if this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the permissibility to relax a little bit some of the orders of the hijab, not to take the hijab off, but to relax it a little bit. If she shows her face, if she shows part of her arm, you know, things like this, and it doesn't cause any fitna or any sins from the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even after making this permissible for them, He says, وَأَن يَسْتَعْفِفْنَ خَيْرٌ لَهُنْ, that if they would choose not to do that, it's better for them. So for her to observe what she used to observe when she was 20 years old, this is even better for her and more rewardable for her, but it's permissible for her to have that ease when it comes to the state of the hijab.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Sheikh. Now, before we wrap things up, I just wanted to get an overall understanding on the concept of ethics in Islam, and then inshallah we'll come towards
the end. Now, the concept of ethics in Islam is that it's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has a divine nature to it, because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Human beings, they fail miserably when it comes to what ethics is. They have general terms of what's good and what's bad, but when it comes to the relationships, and that's why their laws keeps on evolving every year, and what used to be something that is not permissible becomes permissible, and for example, women rights, you know, keeps on evolving. 200 years ago they were abused and now they have some rights and they're still fighting for what rights. What's the criteria to know what is right and what is wrong? You know, people 1,000 years ago, they thought that they were perfectly doing what is correct, but then now after a few years or after hundreds of years, they will discover this was so evil. That's why they need that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's the one that owns the truth, and no one on earth does own the truth. That's why these orders to conduct our actions when it comes to relationship between men and women, you find, for example, now in the work ethics that you are not supposed to be with a woman alone in a room. Why? Because they saw the outcome of this with the abuse, and basically sometimes many companies, they would do that to avoid lawsuits and so on. This is something that is present in our deen 1400 years ago. Not because of money or loss of wealth or lawsuits or whatever, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for our hearts to be purified. People deceive one another, and men deceive women, right? And the media deceive everybody. And they think that if the woman goes out of her home and she takes off her hijab, she's been a very energetic woman, and she's a career-oriented woman, and she's strong and so on. They deceived her. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that wants good for her, He made the rules and the regulations so that protecting her and protecting the society. And what's the most important thing for us is the family. When it comes to relationships to one another, it's not betrayal, it's not based on sins. And that's why good manners and truthfulness and honesty, and even to be honest with someone, and part of the ethics of Islam, even if it caused harm to you. So it's the whole concept of good manners and relationships and workplace and the schools and the streets. We have everything to govern the whole entire life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us.
Alright, thank you very much, Sheikh. That brings us to the end of today's episode. So once again, I want to thank you for coming out here and sharing your beautiful wisdom with us. Thank you,
Sheikh.
And I want to thank both of you, Qari Ibrahim and Qari Abdul Khaliq, for coming out here and sharing your amazing recitations with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dear viewers, I hope you guys enjoyed today's episode. We hope to see you for many more episodes of Quran Circle 2. And until then, may God bless us all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
وما